Welcome back to the video classes, dear students. So now in this session we shall discuss about the MCQs on morphology of flowering plants. So what do you mean by morphology? Morphology is nothing but the study of the external features of an organism. The study of external features of a plant is known as plant morphology, whereas the study of external features of animals is known as animal morphology. So now let us jump into the MCQs on plant morphology, that is morphology of plants, flowering plants. The first question, so the questions are on the root. The roots developed from parts of the plant other than the radical are called option 1 tap roots, option 2 adventitious roots, 3 fibrous roots and 4 all of them. See, usually when a seed germinates, see this is a seed. Assume this as a seed. So when the seed germinates, here we can find the presence of two embryonic axes. So here this one is called as the radical and this one is the plumule. This one is the plumule. So once the seed is germinated, this plumule, it develops, it elongates and it develops into the shoot. So plumule develops into shoot, whereas this radical, it elongates to form the root. It elongates to form the root. And as you all know, there are three different kinds of roots present, like tap roots, fibrous roots and adventitious roots. So here in this case, what happens is in tap roots, the root which has been developed from the radical, I told you that radical, it elongates to form the root. So in case of tap roots, what happens is this root here, this radical, it elongates and becomes more prominent like this. So it becomes more prominent and now this prominent root is called as the primary root. And this undergoes branching to form secondary roots and undergoes further branches to form the tertiary roots. So the primary root together with its branches is called as tap roots. Tap roots are usually seen in case of the dicots. So tap roots, they are usually seen in case of dicots. Whereas in fibrous roots, the tap roots are short-lived. So they will undergo decay and thus a number of fiber-like roots develops from the base of the stem like this. So that is called as fibrous roots. And adventitious roots means those roots which are not developed from the radical part of the embryo. So usually radical, if the roots are developed from the radical part of the embryo, those roots are called as the true roots. So if they develop from the radical, then it is called as true roots. But in case of adventitious roots, the roots develops from any of the part of the plant other than radical. So such kind of root, it is called as the adventitious roots. Okay. So now let us go back to our question. That is, roots develop from the parts of the plant other than radical are called option 1 tap roots, option 2 adventitious roots, 3 fibrous roots and 4 all of them. So what is the right option? It is adventitious roots. And next question, the regions of root from base to root tip are option 1, maturation zone, cell division zone, elongation zone. Second, cell division zone, elongation zone and maturation zone. Third one, maturation zone, elongation zone and cell division zone. And fourth one, elongation zone, cell division zone and maturation zone. So what are the different regions of root from base to root tip, they are asking. So what is the right option? See, when we look at the different regions of the root, see here, this is the root. So when we look at the different regions of root, there are four different regions in the root. Here we can find the presence of the cells which is having the capacity of constant and continuous rapid cell division, and thus this zone is called as the cell division zone. So this is called as the cell division zone. And this zone is covered by a thimble-like cap-like structure which is called as the root cap. And this root cap provides protection to the meristematic tissues when these roots are invading inside the, when they are penetrating inside the soil. and a few millimeters above this we can find the presence of zone of cell elongation. So here we can find the presence of zone of cell elongation, which adds length to the root. And a few millimeters above this we can find the presence of the maturation zone. So maturation zone, that means here the cells undergo structural and functional division, and thus they will be taking up a particular function to perform. And at this zone small thin thread like structures, they arises from the epidermal cells, and these thread like structures are called as root hairs. Okay, now let us move back to the options. So here the regions of root from the base to the root tip are, so what are they? Here we can find the presence of the root cap, and then here comes the maturation zone, elongation zone, and then maturation zone, and then comes the maturation zone. So which is the right option? So and thus here comes the cell division zone, elongation zone, and maturation zone, and thus option 2 is the right one. And next question, the presence of epiphytic roots is the characteristic feature of option 1 cuscuta, in which haustoria is present, option 2 orchids, in which velamen tissue is present, option 3 jersea, in which floating roots are present, and option 4 pinus, in which mycorrhizal association is present. So which is the right option? So epiphytic roots are the characteristic features of orchids. Epiphytes in the sense those plants which lives on other plants just for shelter, so those are called as epiphytes. So which is the right option? Option 2, orchids, in which the velamen tissue is present. Velamen tissue, it is hygroscopic in nature, so it will gain the moisture, it will take up the moisture content which is present in the air, and thus it will be surviving there. So option 2. Next, prop or pillar roots are, option 1 fasciculated roots, 2 adventitious roots, 3 tap roots, and 4th one secondary roots. So what do you mean by prop roots or pillar roots? In case of banyan trees, the branches will be present, and from these branches adventitious roots arises, and these aerial roots, once they touches the ground, they become strong pillar like structures, and thus they will also be imitating the main trunk of the tree, and they are involved in providing the support, mechanical support to the tree. And also as they are imitating the main trunk, they will also develop the roots under the ground, and thus now these are also capable of absorbing water and mineral nutrients. So and thus these are called as the pillar roots or prop roots, and they will be providing the mechanical support to the tree. So which is the right option? Option 2, that is adventitious roots. And next, root pockets are present in, see, they are loose finger glow like structures which will be present in at the tip of, they are present at the tip of the aquatic roots. Options, option 1 Icornia, Pistia, and Lemna. Second option, Ficus, Pothos, and Lemna. Third one, Pandanus and Pistia and Lemna. Fourth one, Icornia, Pistia, and Pothos. As I told you, root pockets are present in floating aquatics. So option 1 is the right one. So root pockets are present in Icornia, Pistia, and Lemna. Next, which of the following is not correct? Option 1, Bryophyllum. Roots arise from the leaf. Of course, in Bryophyllum, roots, they will be arising from the leaf. So if this is the Bryophyllum, here the roots arises. And second option, in maize, roots arise from the base of the stem. Of course, in maize, what happens? So here stem will be differentiated into nodes and internodes. From the basal nodes, adventitious roots arises and they touches the grounds, and these are called as stilt roots. What do we call for them? They are called as the stilt roots. So this option is also right. And third option, mangroves, example Rhizophora, has respiratory roots called as pneumatophores. Of course, as these plants or as these structures they are present in the marshy saline areas, as they has soil has excessive salt, these roots will not be getting enough oxygen, and thus some of the secondary roots they become negatively geotrophic, and they will be growing against to the gravity, and these are called as breathing roots or pneumatophores, and they will also be having small openings which helps in the respiration, and hence these are called as pneumatophores, or they are also called as the breathing roots which are present in rhizopora. And next, fourth one, carrot, that is Daucus carota, has napiform root. See, carrot, it is a root modification, especially the taproot modification. In carrot, what happens is the root, especially the primary root of the carrot, it stores the food material. As a result, it becomes swollen. So it swells like it will be swelling, and thus the base of the root, it will be broadened, and the tips or apex of this will be tapering in nature, which appears like a cone shape. And thus in carrot we come across the presence of conical root but not the napiform root. So napiform root, in the sense the base of the root, it is almost spherical, but towards the apex it becomes tapering suddenly. And this kind of root can be seen in beetroot as well as turnips. So option 4 is the right one. This is incorrect. Next, pneumatophores are found in option 1 epiphytes, 2 xerophytes, 3 the vegetation which is found in saline soil only, and fourth one, vegetation which is found in marshy and saline lake. So which is the right option? Option 4. As I told you earlier, so it is pneumatophores are found in the vegetation which is found in marshy and saline lake, just for the oxygen. And next, the function of stem is option 1, bare leaves and branches, 2, conduction of storage of food, and 3, conduction of water and minerals, and 4, all of this. See, what is a stem? It is a ascending plant axis which is positively phototrophic but negatively geotrophic, and this stem, it can be divided into the nodes as well as internodes, and from the nodal region arises leaves, branches, flowers, and etc. All the organs will be arised from the nodal region of the stem. And the main function of the stem is for providing mechanical support. And the stem is also involved in the translocation of food as well as water. So what is the main function of stem? I'll read out the options. 1, bare leaves and branches, 2, conduction of storage of food, and 3rd one, conduction of water and minerals. So which is the right option? All of these are correct, and hence option 4 is the right one. Option 4 is the right one. Next, which is not a stem modification? Option 1, picture of Nepenthes, 2, corm of Colocasia, 3, rhizome of ginger, and 4th one, tuber of potato. See, first option, here picture of Nepenthes, it is actually not a stem modification. Instead, it is a leaf modification where the leaves are modified to trap the insects. Whereas corm of Colocasia, it is of course a stem modification. Rhizome of ginger and tuber of potato, all these three are stem modification, whereas picture of Nepenthes is not a stem modification, but instead it is a leaf modification. So it is a leaf modification. And next, in which of the following plants stem performs the function of storage and perennation? Option 1, sweet potato, 2, dahlia, 3, onion, 4, turmeric. See here, so they are asking for a stem which is meant for storage and perennation. Perennation in the sense which helps in the vegetative propagation. So sweet potato, it is not a stem modification, but instead it is a root modification. In dahlia, of course, it is also a root modification. onion leaf modification, whereas turmeric, it is a stem modification which is modified for the storage of food materials, and also it helps in the vegetative propagation as this stem, it has nodes and internodes as well as axillary buds, and thus it helps in the perennation also. Option 4. Next, which of the following is a modified stem for the production of plants from browsing animals? Option 1, tendrils, 2, thorns, 3, tuber, and 4, rhizome. So, which of these is a modified stem for protection against grazing animals in the sense? I'll read out the options. 1, tendrils, 2, thorns, 3, tuber, and 4, rhizome. So, tendrils, they will not provide any protection. Thorns, they does. So, here in some cases, what happens? At the axil, these axillary buds, here they will be modified into elongated woody hard thorns, which provides protection to the plants against the grazing animals, and hence option 2 is the right one. Next, the type of stem structure present in colocasia is, so it is present in colocasia is option 1 bulb, 2 corm, 3 rhizome, and fourth one is tuber. So, what is the type of stem structure present in colocasia? It is a corm. Because colocasia, it grows vertically above the ground. So, it grows vertically in the ground. And this will be having circular nodes. As it is a stem, it will be having circular horizontal nodes. And from the nodes arises the axillary buds, which helps in the vegetative propagation, and thus option 2 is the right one. Next, what main function of leaf is? So options 1, exchange of gases, 2, manufacture of food, 3, both A and B, and 4, none of the above. So what is the main function of leaf? Of course, it is involved in the exchange of gases, and also it is the site of manufacture of food by the process called as photosynthesis, and hence third one is the right option, that is both A and B. Next, the largest leaf belongs to option 1 Nerium, 2 Victoria, 3 Tobacco, and fourth one is Rafflesia. So the largest leaf, it belongs to Victoria. Next, a leaf is identified from option 1 flat green lamina, 2 presence of leaf blade and petiole, third one occurrence of chlorophyll, fourth one presence of axillary bud. So how do we identify a leaf? So leaf is identified especially due to the presence of an axillary bud. So you, as I told you here, the stem and leaf makes an angle, and this angle is called as axillary axil, and at this axil arises the buds, which is called as axillary bud. So if axillary bud is present, it indicates it helps in the identification of leaf, and thus option 4 is the right one. Next, venation is a term used to describe the pattern of arrangement of option 1 veins and veinlets in a lamina, 2 floral organs, 3 flower in inflorescence, 4 all of them. So, venation is a term used to define, describe the pattern of arrangement of veins and veinlets in a lamina of leaf, and hence option 1. And next question, parallel venation occurs in option 1 dicots, 2 monocots, 3 ferns, and 4 all angiosperms. So, it is usually found in monocots where the midrib and veins run parallel to each other. So, option 2. Next question. Pinnately parallel venation is found in option 1 grass, 2 canna, 3 zizipers, and 4 castor. So it is found in canna, option 2. Next, which is an insectivorous plant? Option 1 orobanche, 2nd balanophora, 3rd nepenthes, 4th one is Rafflesia. So which of these is an insectivorous plant? It is the Nepenthes, option 3. Next question. Insectivorous plants usually grow in soil which are deficient in option 1 nitrogen or nitrate, 2 calcium or magnesium, and third one organic matter, and fourth one is water. So insectivorous plants, they usually grow in the nitrogen deficient soil, and hence option 1. In which plant the entire leaf is modified into tendril? Option 1, Pisum sativum, 2, Lathyrus sativus, 3, Nepenthes, and 4, Smilax. So it is option 2. In Lathyrus sativus, entire leaf is modified into a tendril. Next, in P, the tendrils are modified. Option 1, stem branches, 2 leaves, 3 leaflets, and 4 stipules. So in P, the tendrils are nothing but the modified leaves. So they are the modified leaves, option 2. And next question, the leaves are modified into spines. In option 1, Opuntia, 2, Nepenthes, 3, Utricularia, Australian Acacia. So the leaves are modified into spines in Opuntia. So Opuntia, here the stem is modified into a free green colored flattened structure called phylloclade. And here what happens is the leaves will be highly reduced and they will be in the form of spines just to avoid the excessive loss of water, and also this provides protection against the grazing animals. So option 1. Next, the flowers of a racemes are arranged. Option 1, centripetally, 2, basipetally, 3, acropetally, 4th one, centrifugally. So in case of racemose inflorescence, the flowers, they are arranged in an acropetal succession, because the smaller and younger flowers are born at the top, whereas the older flowers will be present at the bottom. So option 3. Next, non-essential parts of flowers are option 1, sepals and carpels. Option 2, sepals and petals. Option 3, sepals and gynecium. And option 4, antrichum and gynecium. So which are the non-essential parts of a flower? It is, those non-essential parts of a flower are nothing but the parts which does not take place in the reproduction, and thus it is the sepals and petals, option 2. And thus they are also called as the accessory whorls. They are called as accessory whorls. Whorls. So whorls, in the sense, here we can say it as calyx and corolla. So these are non-essential whorls or accessory whorls of a flower. Next, the fourth whorl of a flower is option 1, sepals, 2, petals, 3, stamens, and 4, carpels. So which is the outermost whorl of the flower? See, here when we speak about the whorls, so here comes the calyx, corolla, antrichum, and gynecium. So calyx is the outermost whorl of the flower, and the individual units of calyx is known as the sepals. So which is the right option? It is the option number 1, sepals. Next, thalamus is hypogynous flower in option 1, concave, option 2, convex, option 3, flat, and option 4, partly cup shaped. Option 2. Next, the technical term used for the antrichium in a flower of China rose, Hibiscus rosa sinensis, is option 1, diadelphus, 2, monadelphus, 3, polyadelphus, and 4, polyandrus. So which is the technical term used in antrichium of hibiscus? See here, the stamens, the many number of stamens, they all are fused to form a single bundle, and thus it is called as monadelphus stamens in case of hibiscus. And next question, union of stamens with carpels form a complex called option 1, syngenecious, 2, gynostegium, 3, gynandrium, and 4th one, 2 and 3. So it is option 4. Next, what type of placentation is seen in a sweet pea? Option 1, marginal, option 2, axile, option 3, free central, option 4, basal. So what kind of placentation is seen in sweet pea. Here we come across the presence of marginal placentation. So option 1. Next, the placenta is attached to the developing seed near the option 1 micropyle, 2 testa, 3 hilum and 4 funicle. So it is the option 4. The placenta is attached to the developing seed near the funicle. Next, in Dianthus, placentation is option 1 free central, 2 basal, 3 marginal, 4 axile. It is free central placentation, option 1. Next question. Gynecium having 3 fused carpels with a single ovule containing chamber is. See here, they are asking for the condition. If the gynecium is having 3 carpels, that condition is known as tricarpellary. And if they are fused, the term syn is used for representing the fused condition. So, if these 3 carpels are fused, then it is called as syncarpus with a single ovule containing chamber. That means chamber refers to the locules. So, how can we describe that? It can be described as tricarpellary, syncarpus, trilocular. So, I'll read out the options. Option 1, tricarpellary, syncarpus, unilocular. And option 2, tricarpellary, syncarpus, trilocular. Third one, tricarpellary, polycarpellary, unilocular. Fourth option, tricarpellary, polycarpellary and trilocular. So, which is the option? Option 1. That means tricarpellary, syncarpus and unilocular. Option 1. And next question. Out of 5 petals of a flower, 2 are completely internal, 2 are completely external. I'll read out the question once more. Out of 5 petals of a flower, 2 are completely internal. So here, out of 5 petals, 2 are completely internal and 2 are completely external. Whereas the remaining one is, it will be showing one is internal at one margin and external at the other margin. So what kind of aestivation it is, they are asking. So they are asking for the kind of aestivation. And option 1, ascending imbricate, 2 quincuncial, 3 vexillary and 4th one, valvate. So which is the right option? It is quincuncial, it is the right option. So quincuncial is the kind of aestivation which is seen in this kind of aestivation. Option 2. And next, edible part of mango is option 1, epicarp, 2 mesocarp, 3 endocarp and 4 receptacle. So which is the part of the mango we eat? It is mesocarp. See here, the fruit wall of the wall of the fruit is called as pericarp. It is called as pericarp. And this pericarp is differentiated into outer, middle and inner fruit layer or wall. Outer layer or outer wall of the fruit is called as epicarp, and middle one is called as mesocarp, and the innermost is called as endocarp. So the edible part of the mango is the middle wall, which is called as mesocarp. Option 2. Next, fruit of brinjal, option 1, hesperidium, and they are asking for the type of fruit in case of brinjal. Option 1, hesperidium, 2 berry, 3 pome and 4th one is drupe. So which kind of fruit it is? In brinjal we can find the presence of many number of the seeds present. So option 2, it is a kind of berry. Option 2, the fruits developed from ovary and other floral parts except ovary are called. Option 1, false and true fruits respectively. Second, true and false fruits respectively. Third, neither false nor true fruit. And fourth one, all of the above. The fruits developed from ovary. See, if the fruits are developed from the fertilized ovary, they are called as true fruits. And if the fruits which are developed other than ovary, so if the fruits are developed from the thalamus, so such kind of fruits are called as other floral parts, if they are arise, then that kind is called as false fruits. So which is the right option? If the fruits which are developed from the ovary, they are called as true fruits. and if they develop from other floral parts except ovary, so that is called as the false fruits. So which is the right option? Option 2. And next, structure of a dicotyledonous seed. Questions on that. Which one of the following is endospermic seed? Endospermic seed, in the sense it will be having the nutritive structure, I mean substance present in the seed. So option 1, bean, 2 pea, 3 castor and 4 gram. So which is the endospermous seed? It is option 3, castor. Here we can find the presence of the endosperm. And next question, in the exalbuminous seed, the food is stored within. Option 1, testa, 2, endosperm, 3, cotyledon, 4, plumule. So it is stored in cotyledons, leafy like thick and fleshy structures, which are called as cotyledons, option 3. And next, testa of seed develops from. So testa of seed, it develops from. Option 1, ovary wall, 2, outer integument, 3, hilum and 4, funicle. So the testa of seed, it develops from the outer integument, option 2. Which of the following is not correct? One, option 1, endospermic monocot seeds are maize. So here we have to refer to the pairs, whether they are correct or not. So endospermic monocot seeds are maize, of course. So maize, it is an endospermic monocot seed. Non-endospermic monocot seeds, pothos, of course. Third option, endospermic dicot seeds are papaya, of course. These are dicot seeds which will be having endosperms inside. And fourth option, non-endospermic seed dicots, vallisneria. So which is not correct? It is option 4. In coconut fruit, the hard shell is option 1, fused structure of mesocarp and endocarp. Second one, endocarp. Third one, epicarp. And fourth one, fused structure of epicarp and mesocarp. So in coconut fruit, the hard shell is actually the mesocarp, which is actually fused with that of the endocarp. So option 1. And next, after removal of covering in pea, the seed consists of option 1, embryo only, and option 2, cotyledon plus embryo. Cotyledon plus embryo. Third one, cotyledons plus endosperm. And fourth one, cotyledons plus endosperm plus pericarp. So after the removal of covering in P, the seed consists of the cotyledon as well as the embryo. So option 2. Next, tegument develops from option 1, inner integument, 2, outer integument, 3, funicules and 4, chalaza. So tegment, it always develops from the inner integument, and option 1. Next, allurone layer is option 1, disintegrated secondary nucleus, 2, peripheral part of endosperm, 3, remnant of endosperm, 4, a proteinaceous layer covers like endosperm. So what is this allurone layer? In case of monocot seeds, what happens? It is a proteinaceous layer which is present, and that covers the endosperm. Endosperm, it will be present here. So this protein layer is called as allurone layer, which actually covers the endosperm. So option 4. Next, allurone layer of maize grain is specially rich in option 1, starch, 2, marigold, 3, rose and 4, proteins. So it is especially rich in proteins, and hence option 4. Semi-technical description of a typical flowering plant. And next, in the next question, they has given a floral formula like actinomorphic, bisexual, calyx having 2 plus 2 arrangement, corolla showing 4 plus 4 arrangement, gynecium. So here superior, which is bicarpellary and syncarpous condition. So this can be seen in option 1, citrus, aurantum. Second one, hibiscus, rosa sinensis. Third one, solanum nigrum. And fourth one, brassica campestris. So which is the right option? This is, it belongs to brassica campestris, option 4. Next, identify the family containing mustard and its main characteristics. Option 1, brassicaceae, pentamerous flowers, many stamens, pentacarpellary, gynecium and capsule fruit. Second, Brassicaceae, tetramerous flowers, six stamens, bicarpellary, gynecium, siliqua fruit. And third option, Solanaceae, pentamerous flowers, five stamens, bicarpellary, gynecium, berry, fruit. And fourth one, Poaceae, trimerous flowers, three stamens, monocarpellary, gynecium, and caropsis, fruit. So, which belongs to the Brassicaceae family? So, here we come across the tetramerous flowers, and they will be having six stamens, which may be arranged in 4 plus 2 or 2. So, 4 plus 2, here 2 stamens will be large and 4 stamens will be small, and bicarpellary gynecium and fruit is siliqua. So, option 2. Next, description of some important families on these questions. Bicarpellary gynecium and oblique ovary occur in option 1, banana. So, it is make it as banana. Second, mustard. Third one, brinjal. And fourth one, pisum. So, bicarpellary gynecium and oblique ovary, it occurs in brinjal. That is option 3. Next, keel is characteristic of flowers of option 1, bean. 2, gulmohar. 3, cassia. And fourth one, calotropes. So, keel, it is the characteristic feature of bean. Option 1. Because keel is present in, it is seen in the leguminosae family. So, option 1. Next, the characteristic fruit of family leguminosae is option 1, cremocarp. 2, rigma. 3, siliqua. And fourth one, legume or pod. So, which is the right option? Option 4. Because it is the characteristic feature of the family leguminosae. So, here we come across the presence of a pod, and it is also called as a legume. Next question. Which of the following plants has the floral characters like zygomorphic flower, vexillary estivation? Options 1, belladonna. 2, pisum. 3, brinjal. Fourth one, asparagus. So, zygomorphic flower, in the sense when a flower is cut, the flower can be cut into two equal halves only when if we cut it in a single vertical plane. And if we cut it on any other vertical plane, we will not get two equal halves. So, that is called as the zygomorphic flowers, and it is the characteristic feature of the leguminosae family. So, which is the right option? Option 2, pisum, which belongs to the same family, and this option 2. Next, the anthers in Solanaceae are option 1, Dithecus extrose, 2, Indehiscent, 3, Sahysocarpic, and fourth one, Dithecus. The anthers in Solanaceae are the Dithecus anthers, option 4. And next, in which family pentamerous flowers having monoadelphous stamen and dry dehiscent fruit are option 1, Leguminosae, 2, Malvaceae, 3, Solanaceae, and fourth one, Liliaceae. So, option 2, Malvaceae. And you have to solve the questions which has given in the student drill.